evacuation effort. The U.S. military works to save Americans in Afghanistan. White House response. The National Security Advisor faces tough questions about what went wrong. International response. How China views the Taliban takeover. And humanitarian crisis. What the fall of Afghanistan means for the people left behind. On EWTN News Nightly for Tuesday, August 17th, 2021. Thank you so much for being with us tonight. I'm Tracy Sable. In Afghanistan, the Taliban addresses international fears whether their regime will respect human rights, declaring an amnesty across the country and urging women to join their government. Today's comments come as the Taliban captures control of Kabul at the main airport. Desperate crowds continue efforts to flee the country despite Taliban reassurances. There have been reports of armed groups patrolling the streets of the capital in search of those who worked with the ousted government. The White House is responding to intense criticism of the chaotic evacuation efforts in Afghanistan. Today, the National Security Advisor took questions in the press briefing room, while the Pentagon says the evacuations are back on track. White House correspondent Owen Jensen reports.
What went wrong and who's to blame? Those are just some of the questions the Biden administration is facing tonight.
National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan goes before reporters in the White House press briefing room. The main question, how did the U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan nosedive into bedlam?
When a civil war comes to an end with an opposing force marching on the Capitol, there are going to be scenes of chaos. There are going to be lots of people leaving the country.
The White House wanted out of Afghanistan, but President Joe Biden and his advisors clearly did not envision scenes like this unfolding.
The images from the past couple of days at the airport have been heartbreaking. But President Biden had to think about the human costs of the alternative path as well, which was to stay in the middle of a civil conflict in Afghanistan.
Over at the Pentagon, this update on the evacuation process at the airport in Kabul.
Right now, we're looking at one aircraft per hour in and out of Hekaya. We predict that our best effort could look like 5,000 to 9,000 passengers departing per day.
Meanwhile, in Kabul, the Taliban held its own news conference saying there would be no violence against women in Afghanistan and vowing to respect women's rights.
My heart goes out to Afghan women and girls in the country today under the Taliban. We've seen what they've done before, and that's a very hard thing for any of us to face.
Many Afghans remain fearful and skeptical after the Taliban imposed a brutal rule in the late 1990s. The president of the political consulting firm Eurasia Group says the Biden administration failed in Afghanistan.
It's a lack of planning for what happens if your scenarios go wrong. And it's a lack of communications, of honesty with the American people and with allies around the world.
And Senator Lindsey Graham writes, President Biden chose a dangerous and dishonorable path in Afghanistan, and he has no one to blame for this debacle but himself.
Jake Sullivan also said they knew that once the Taliban arrived in the Afghan capital, U.S. troops on the ground or no U.S. troops on the ground, that a significant number of people would start heading to the airport to evacuate. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
And on the ground in Afghanistan, there are major humanitarian concerns, especially for women and children. Videos of Afghan citizens clinging to American aircrafts, as we've seen, and eventually falling to their deaths, spread across social media yesterday, showcasing the extreme desperation of those trying to flee the country. And joining me now is Aloysius John, Secretary General of Caritas Internationalis. Aloysius, welcome back. Always good to see you. As we mentioned a little bit ago, the Taliban is now urging women to join the government. Not really something that you would expect from the Taliban. Why do you think they are inviting women to have a role in the government? It sounds positive, but is this something that we should be skeptical of?
First of all, good afternoon to you, and thank you for inviting me. I think it's a very difficult question to respond to, because here we are speculating on what is going to happen in the future and what are the intentions. But at this moment for Caritas Internationalis, I think we are more worried about the humanitarian situation and the reality of life of these millions of people. Because in Afghanistan, when you talk about Afghanistan, we're talking about 10 million children who are needing humanitarian assistance. One-third of the population is facing food crisis. And there is, since the conflict, 550,000 people are internally displaced. And our thoughts are with these people. I would not like to speculate on the intention of the Taliban, whether they want to do it or what they want to do or what they are doing. So our main concern is the humanitarian concern. And today the key point for us is how to bring support, humanitarian support, and reach out to these 8 million people who are needing food support, food security, and also a safe place to live. And the humanitarian community has been helping them. How do we continue is the key challenge for us today.
And can you tell us a little bit about what you are doing to help them?
The Caritas Network has always, as you know, Caritas Network has always been there for saving lives of the people in dire situations like the one which we are facing today. And there is Afghanistan, Haiti is another situation where the earthquake also is calling us. For Afghanistan, we have to focus on three areas. First of all, the huge humanitarian needs. We have to assess them to see what could be done and how we should go about it. The second one is we need to reflect on the security situation, how we are going to secure the duty of care for the humanitarian workers and also the care for the people, how to bring them to safe places. The third one is the mitigation of the different risk. We need to take them into consideration and also to see how we get into a situation of dialogue, even with the Taliban, to really care for the people who are there in the country.
Aloysius, what are you most concerned about right now for the people that are living there?
Our major concern today is food insecurity. How do we get food across to the people? That's one important area. The second important area is there has been schools which have been in the past run by small communities. We have been funding them. So how do we continue to fund these schools there to educate the children? Many young girls were educated. So how do we continue to educate these young girls? And what needs to be done to ensure that education is one challenge which we need to address, and this is something which will be done on the long run. And thirdly, we also have to think in terms of how do we enable the community to go in for small agricultural activities. How to make them stabilize the communities will be another concern for us which we need to address.
And before I let you go, what can we do, if anything, to help in this situation?
I'm sorry, I didn't get.
What can we do in this situation to help those in Afghanistan right now? How can we get involved?
How can we get involved? First of all, I think there is a need for funding the programs which Caritas Network is putting in place. There are different programs for food security which are being undertaken. We need to continue to ensure that people are receiving food and the basic needs. And this is something for which we will be needing means, funds for them. And also, secondly, we need also to bring the people to safe places, because many of them are on the road to exile. We have to give them security, and we need to need tents and put them in places where they could be settled, first of all, till they go back to their villages. And thirdly, we have to see also how we could ensure the return back to normal. So areas of education, taking care of the children, and also the women who have been very pivotal in the development, in the micro development, how to ensure that they continue to play this role. So these are the different activities which will be taking into consideration in the future.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us. Aloysius John, Secretary General of Caritas Internationalis. Thank you for your time today.
Thank you very much.
Well, Chinese officials say they are ready to continue to deepen their relationship with Afghanistan. This after the Taliban took control of the country. Beijing's foreign minister blames the United States for the Taliban taking power in Afghanistan, saying the, quote, hasty military retreat led to the current chaos that China shares a narrow border with Afghanistan. Leaders of the Taliban met late last month with Chinese officials. And joining us now is Gordon Chang, author of both The Coming Collapse of China and The Great U.S.-China Tech War. Gordon, welcome back. Always so great to see you. First off, your thoughts on the situation in Afghanistan, and how do you think China factors into the equation as far as the new Afghanistan, now currently controlled by the Taliban?
Beijing will support the Taliban. Their embassy is open, which is an indication that there are continuing relations. That's also true for Russia as well. But China has had strong relations with the Taliban, both before and after 9/11. And so we shouldn't be surprised that Beijing is fully supporting this group. This means that China will become involved in Afghanistan. It will be influential, at least with the Taliban. And the one other thing, Tracy, is that the enemies of the Taliban become enemies of China.
Yeah, and Gordon, tell us a little bit more about this relationship with China and the Taliban. You know, I know that Beijing has met with the Taliban a number of times over the years, as you mentioned, and most recently last month in China. What do we know about that meeting? And also, what about the interest in Afghanistan for China? Can you talk about that?
The senior leadership of the Taliban met with Foreign Minister Wang Yi in Tianjin, a Chinese city, on July, I think, 30 and 31st. And we have readouts from the Chinese Foreign Ministry, but they don't really tell us very much. And the issue there that I think we should be looking at is funding. Did China fund the Taliban? Because obviously their campaign to take over the government required money. And probably it came from outside sources. So this is important for us to take a look at. In terms of what China wants, I think China, first of all, is defensive because it was very happy with the U.S. in Afghanistan because we were spending resources and it was stabilizing the country. Now China has to do that. Now China does want things. It wants minerals, for instance. It wants Belt and Road. It wants the Taliban to help them with regard to the Uyghurs, not to provide a refuge for them. But nonetheless, I think Beijing right now is more concerned about what it can lose rather than what it can gain.
Yeah. In an opinion piece in Chinese state media today, it said, if the U.S. failed in Afghanistan, how can it hope to win a, quote, major power game with Beijing? I'd like to get your thoughts on that, Gordon.
Yeah, there are two major propaganda themes. That's one of them, that the U.S. can no longer confront China. In other words, deterrence is failing. And we have seen that in a number of propaganda releases recently. The other one is Taiwan, where Beijing is saying to the government in Taipei that you can't rely on the U.S. when we invade you. And they actually use the when. The United States will depart immediately and won't help you. So really what Beijing is looking at is an opportunity to, first of all, disrupt American relationships around the world, but also sees this as an opportunity to take Taiwan. And by the way, Tracy, Beijing today just announced two exercises of their Navy and their Air Force, both southeast and southwest of Taiwan.
Yeah, and that was going to be my next question to you, Gordon. Talk a little bit more about that and the significance of those war games.
Yeah. In the beginning of this year, Tracy, the Chinese Air Force and the Chinese Navy were on Taiwan's borders every single day. And then there was this very long pause. And there's a number of reasons for it, but they've started up recently. And obviously the starting up has something to do with Beijing's belief that the U.S. can no longer support Taiwan. This is really, really dangerous. You know, we've seen these themes when China's top two diplomats went to Anchorage in the middle of March, and they said that the U.S. was no longer in a position to talk to China with strength. And that really means that deterrence right now is iffy. And since that time, there have been these other messages, basically China saying that the U.S. is done and has to get out of the way. And that means China's going to be extremely provocative. And Russia, Iran, North Korea could take advantage of the situation as well. We could have conflict across the European and Asian landmass overnight.
Very concerning, Gordon. Always great to have you on. Thank you so much for your time. Gordon Chang, author of both The Coming Collapse of China and The Great U.S.-China Tech War. Thanks again.
Thanks, Tracy.
Coming up, coronavirus crisis. Why fully vaccinated Americans may soon need a booster shot. The Biden administration is expected to advise Americans who have been vaccinated that they should also receive a COVID-19 booster shot. Dr. Francis Collins, the head of the National Institutes of Health, says the booster shot would be administered roughly 8 months following the full vaccination. It is around then that the vaccine can lose some effectiveness. Previously now, federal health officials said that boosters were not needed by the general public. While citing USCCB guidance, the Archdiocese of Los Angeles will not provide religious exemption letters to individuals who object to receiving a COVID-19 vaccine. The statement from the Archdiocese of Los Angeles is the latest from U.S. church leaders regarding coronavirus vaccinations. Earlier this month, bishops in Colorado emphasized the need to respect those with moral objections. And earlier this week, bishops of South Dakota said the faithful should be free to seek a religious exemption from any vaccine mandate. And joining us now is Dr. Joseph Meaney, president of the National Catholic Bioethics Center. Dr. Meaney, welcome back. Always so good to be with you. As we mentioned, and as you know, there does not really seem to be a consensus among the bishops here in the U.S. regarding religious exemptions for the vaccine. Really no surprise. This is really making it confusing for the faithful. I know you and I have talked about this before, but remind us again what church teaching says when it comes to making a decision about medical intervention such as a vaccine.
Right. So, I mean, there's medical informed consent, which means that bedrock medical ethics, that one is required to get as much information and receive as much information as possible to be able to make a good decision about all the different alternatives that that are before a person. And when it comes to, you know, ethical issues, to be fully aware of those as well, to be able to discern in conscience. And that is so important right now with regard to the COVID-19 vaccine, because there are a lot of questions that are out there, and people do need to be able to reflect and to come to a very good, conscientious decision on what they want to do.
Yeah. You know, and there's been a lot of talk about vaccine mandates, as you know, as people get ready to go back to school or back to work, even eat in a restaurant in some places. Does the church say anything about requiring people to take a vaccine or any type of medical intervention in such times as these or in general?
Right. So, in general, the church does not. You know, it's left to the individual discernment of individuals. Now, there is a lot of talk about the common good, right? And thinking about solidarity in times of a pandemic. And that is a real concern that people should be thinking about. You know, is it good for me? Is it good for society to do this? But it does come down finally to each individual having to make a decision.
Yeah. Also, you know, we're seeing cities and even countries like Italy adopt a COVID-19 passport, which verifies your vaccine status, and then people have to show that in order to enter things like the Vatican Museums or other indoor gathering places. I'd like to get your thoughts on that, Dr. Meaney, and possible implications of these so-called digital passports. How do you see that playing out?
Right. I would definitely push for alternatives, including the fact that, you know, people like right now to do international travel have to show proof of a negative test. And, you know, some of these vaccine passports would have that possibility to say, look, I was recently tested negative, and therefore there's no issue and I can go and be very safe. The difficulty is to require something that a person, you know, in conscience might refuse, then is barring them from certain activities that would be normal for them to be able to participate in, particularly if there are ways to do that safely, right? For instance, showing that they have a negative test.
Yeah, there are so many questions that surround this, and I'm sure we'll be talking to you again soon. Thank you so much for your time, Dr. Meaney, and weighing in. We always appreciate it.
Thank you.
Up next, Eastern Rite Catholics, how the Vatican is reaching out. And pet blessing, people pray for the intercession of saints. Earlier this month, Pope Francis appointed 8 new members of the Vatican Group responsible for dialogue with Eastern Rite Catholics. The Congregation for the Eastern Churches deals with the growth and safeguarding of the Armenian, Byzantine, Coptic, and Syrian rites. The Holy Father's 8 appointments included 4 priests and 4 professors. Joining us now is one of the appointees, Professor Elena Velkovska, a professor at the University of Siena in Italy. Professor, thank you so much for your time today. We appreciate it. And congratulations on your new position. Can you tell us a little bit more about it and your reaction when you heard the news?
Thank you. Well, being appointed as a consultant to a congregation of the Holy See is a honor and a responsibility. In addition to a personal gratitude for this assignment, I must also express my surprise when I saw that the new consultors for the liturgy do not come from the pontifical universities of Rome, as they used to until now. Indeed, unlike the situation in the Church of Rome, Eastern liturgical studies have traditionally been in the hands of lay scholars, both women and men. And this is particularly evident in the Greek Orthodox Church, but there are many lay theologians and liturgical scholars also in the Russian Orthodox Church and in many other local churches. And this is the first time that the Holy See takes note of this reality and assigns lay scholar in such a prestigious position.
And for those who may not be familiar, can you remind us some of the differences and maybe some of the similarities between Eastern Rite Catholics and Latin Rite Catholics?
Well, they belong to very different traditions, as you know, and the Eastern Catholics start only a few centuries ago as a result of a historical process of the union between Orthodox Christians and the See of Rome, because of political difficulties, mostly depending on the Turkish conquest on of Constantinople. So they are much newer, and the difference are that the Eastern Catholic Christians, they just conserve their liturgy and their ecclesiological traditions, but they belong to the Holy See jurisdictionally. This is the main difference.
And you can you talk to us about the Congregation for the Eastern Churches, how it will help dialogue between the Eastern Rite and the Latin Rite, and also does it do outreach to the Orthodox Churches as well?
Well, no, the Orthodox Church and the relationships between the Orthodox Churches and the Holy See is in the hands of another congregation, which is not just a congregation, but this is the Committee for Christian Unity, while the Congregation for the Eastern Catholic Churches has a different role with respect to the physiognomy of the individual Greek Catholic Churches or Eastern Catholic Churches. So for the patriarchal and major archiepiscopal churches in which a synodal form of self-government is in force, the role of the congregation is one of simple coordination, while for the metropolitan and eparchial, so diocesan churches, the congregation also deals with episcopal appointments. Currently, the congregation holds all the competencies for the Oriental churches that are assigned to many other dicasteries or so ministries in the Latin Church, with the exceptions, with the exception of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith.
Well, Professor, thank you so much for joining us today, and congratulations again, Professor Elena Velkovska, consultant for the Congregation for the Eastern Churches. Thank you again.
Thank you, and many, many good wishes for your spectators.
And finally tonight, in Bolivia, devout faithful, including the country's president, participated in the traditional blessing of a pet commemorating the feast of Saint Roch. With their pastor, parishioners of the Body of Christ Church in El Alto participated in the joyous blessing ceremony. It took place yesterday. St. Roch lived in the early 1300s and is invoked as a patron for dogs and for those who are suffering during epidemics. And for equal time, we should mention the patroness of pet cats. Well, her name is St. Gertrude of Neville, who shares the feast day of March 17th, of course, with St. Patrick. And we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.